I want to talk to you about a border. A border that crosses other borders. One that you don't need a passport to cross. One of the most influential borders in the world, yet one which much of the world says doesn't even exist. If, like me, you were taught the seven-continent view of the world, you will know that this is Europe and this is Asia. With, say, Belgium and Vietnam being so incomprehensibly different from one another that we assign them to different continents, where do we put the dividing line? The Eurasian border is unique because it's the one continental boundary defined not by any waterway, well actually by quite a few waterways, but by mountains. Nowadays, we have collectively decided that the boundaries of Europe and Asia end at the Caucasus and Ural Mountains. But the idea of Europe and Asia being divided has been around for thousands of years, and where exactly to put the dividing point isn't something we've always agreed on. So, how do we get to this point? How did we used to divide the supercontinent? And in fact, why do we even divide this one landmass in this way anyway? This video is brought to you by Morning Brew. The reason we define Europe as its own continent and not some sort of giant peninsula in Western Asia is because… history. Perhaps it is appropriate I talk about these islands right here in the Aegean Sea, as it was ancient Greek cartographers who first made this distinction. In the 6th century BC, when all the lands people in this general area knew about looked like this, there was this one guy from Miletus named Anaximander. According to several Greek cartographers and philosophers that came after him, Anaximander was the first to ever publish a true map of the world. And this world map had one huge distinction. Well, I mean, aside from being existent when all others at the time weren't. To the ancient Greeks, the center of the world was the Aegean Sea and its hundreds and hundreds of islands. Anywhere to the east of the sea was Asia, anywhere to the west was Europe, and anywhere to the south was Libya. This concept gave a lot of people a lot of different ideas on what role the Greeks themselves played amongst the different continents. While some historians argue that perhaps European Greeks used it against those who had fallen to Persian domination, others at the time excluded the Aegean Islands and the Peloponnese, and therefore the Hellenic peoples themselves, from this continental model altogether, with the concept of Europe being more associated with the non-Greek Thracians to the north. But even back in this time, people knew that Europe and Asia were in fact connected by land north of the Black Sea, and had already begun to question why two conjoined regions would be their own separate continents. Talk about the original Euroskeptics. Writing in the 1st century BC, Strabo made the observation, in giving names to the three continents, the Greeks did not take into consideration the whole habitable earth, but merely their own country and the land exactly opposite. Anaximander defined the border between Europe and Asia as following the Phasis, now Rioni, river in Georgia, until it reached the Caspian Sea, somewhere, and the border between Asia and Africa as the Nile. Throughout the Roman era and the Middle Ages, European cartographers largely followed Ptolemy's version, through the Turkish Straits into the Black Sea, then through the Kerch Strait into the Sea of Azov, and then following the Don River to… wherever it ended up. However, by the 16th or 18th centuries, this definition was starting to get a bit problematic, as Russia was expanding into the very lands that the smart dead people in Greece never knew about. As European cartographers came to know about more of the world, including, get this, a fourth continent, it became obvious that the Nile and the Don might not have been the best geographic features to separate Asia from Africa and Europe, and thus new dividing lines had to be figured out. With Asia and Africa, it was pretty easy. You see that huge sea that almost connects to the Mediterranean here? Yeah, put the border there, dummy. In 1725, German-Swedish geographer Philip Johann von Strahlenberg, who was also dead, redefined the border to follow the Volga River from the Caspian Sea until where it bends near the city of Samara, also known as the Samara Bend. It then followed the division between the drainage basins of the Volga and Ural rivers, known as Upshusert, before following the Ural Mountains into the Arctic Ocean. As the Russian Tsar Peter the Great was on his whole Russia is actually Western shtick, Russian intellectuals associated with him basically went, "Sweet, this puts so much more of our country in Europe. Look, we're totally Western. Check out our new tricolor flag." However, other scholars across Russia and the rest of Europe would fiercely debate this idea, with some still wanting to use the Don, and others wanting to go as far east as the Ob or the Yenisei. But eventually, the Urals were the one thing just about everyone could agree on, and to a lesser extent the Caspian. However, as the universe inherently doesn't care about the whims of some hairless apes who argue over which way toilet paper should be hung, the Urals don't actually extend all the way to the Caspian. Increasingly, cartographers started to put the boundary along the Ural River until it reached the Caspian, going down the sea about two-thirds of the way before turning to the northwest and then going along the Caucasus Mountains instead of any river. But even then, the division wasn't completely set in stone, with Soviet geographers in the 1950s proposing the divide instead follow the Kumamonish Depression in the Caucasus. Nowadays, the dividing line follows the eastern foothills of the Urals, then the Ural River into the Caspian, and then along the watershed of the Caucasus Mountains before emptying into the Black Sea and passing through the Turkish Straits, therefore making both Turkey and Greece transcontinental countries. But if this division is all about culture, what about Georgia, Armenia, and Cyprus? Culturally, historically, and geopolitically, these nations have all had much more to do with Europe, and yet they all find themselves mostly or entirely on the Asian side of the divide. What I think this sort of tells us about humanity is how even human things evade the human desire to sort everything into neat little categories. The most empirical way to divide a continent, at least without including islands, might be to just count after Eurasia, the Americas, Antarctica, and Australia. But if we think about it, that's not what most of us use continents for. The way we actually use continents, as a way to categorize the peoples and cultures of this mudball floating through space, doesn't really jive well with this definition if we only count landmasses with populations of a few hundred, 25 million, 1 billion, and 6.7 billion. God, imagine what it would be like if Europe and Asia had random little enclaves and exclaves within each other.
Okay, but you can't just write off the Mariner Valley like that. Have you seen what's going on in Arcadia? It's a war zone over there. I don't care about what's happening on Luna or Mars. I want incriminating pictures of Spider-Man. Okay, well let's tune into our reporter on the scene in Shackleton right now. Thanks, Daryl. The situation in the crater region is actually completely totally normal, but we still have another 23 hours and 59 minutes left of program to fill. When does this have reporter using Morning Brew to receive their daily news in a way that actually leaves them informed, fulfilled, and hopefully not wanting to strangle someone?
Interesting. Do tell us more about this Morning Brew thing.
Morning Brew is a daily newsletter covering stories in business, finance, and tech with witty, informative articles written in a non-pretentious tone. I've actually been subscribed to them for several months now, and thanks to them, it only takes me 5 minutes every morning to catch up on the news that everyone's screaming about on that given day. For example, did you know that just last week, actually about 200 years ago for us, Intel announced that they're breaking ground on a chip-making plant in Ohio, which will be the largest of its kind in the inner solar system? In other news, Starbucks has also announced a new loyalty program using NFTs.
Okay, that's all great to know, but why are you taking 3 seconds to respond to me every time?
Because I'm literally on the moon and this is supposed to be a realistic scenario?
Folks, this just in, you can sign up for Morning Brew by clicking the link in the description or by going to morningbrewdaily.com/KhAnubis and signing up with your email.
Oh, and did I forget to mention something?
It's completely free!